extent, Pastor Don remembers meeting me long before I met him, because I was probably in Florida at Faith Farm or something. Or was it IBC?
I met you at Destiny Church.
And Destiny Church, Revival Temple. I was a sound man at Revival Temple and working my way through Bible college. And so our lives have crossed so much so that when Pastor Don was in my truck this morning and I called my pastor, Mike Van Britsen, in Illinois, they began to talk. And Pastor Don said, "Do you know Patsy, this lady that was in his church in Evansville, Indiana?" He said, "Oh, yeah, I know that family well." And Don said, "Well, they were my worship pastors for 28 years. He said, "Well, come on." And so all of a sudden, these connections don't even know each other, and you get them on the phone. Heaven is going to be an incredible place. When we get there, we realize all these connections that we've made and things that have happened. I don't want to waste any more time. I want you to have your Bibles ready, amen, to listen to this man of God. And listen, the things that Pastor Don, the years he pastored in Los Angeles, the things he went through. You're actually from Arkansas, is that right?
No, Tennessee.
Tennessee, okay. I knew it was one of them awkward states.
The
amen.
One that loses Alabama every year.
Yeah. You could use this if you want to. You can do that. Is that good? Does that work?
So? We'll say so.
Y'all give Pastor Don a hand. Would you do that?
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? How we doing, brother? Are we there? Hey, I like this place. This is a crazy place, isn't it? Yeah. I come here to straighten your pastor out. I told somebody that before church. He said, "Well, you're going to have to be here for a long time." So we're just going to turn it into a series, because it's going to take a series to get this boy straightened out. I'm here today, because not very many people ask me anymore. No, I'm just kidding. And I knew Jerry needed redeemed. Pastor Jerry needed to be redeemed, so I'm here today to straighten him out. I like this place. I could go to church here. Amen. This is a noisy church, I'm telling you. This is the closest thing to being at home. It's like sitting down at a home-cooked meal here, being with you guys. This church is so much like Desert Rain in Los Angeles. And if you're if you're looking that up right now on your smartphone, that's spelled R-E-I-G-N. I just learned nowadays, if you say there was 300, if Mighty Men of Valor or whatever, somebody's on Google right there while you're preaching, looking it up. But 36 years in Los Angeles, and now we're in Tennessee. And this is the closest place I've been to in over a year. I'm telling you, I could go to church here. I'm serious,
Thank you.
I'm serious. I love this place. Last time I was here, it was in a funeral home.
Right.
I've been to a lot of funeral home services since. They just don't know it. Amen. Love the music. Love the spirit of the house. It's just amazing. No matter where you go, God's people are the same, aren't they?
Amen.
How many know it's okay to laugh in church?
Amen.
Yeah, I thought y'all might know that. I did think, maybe while I'm here, I could cast out that spirit of timidity out of your pastor. He's bound with a spirit of just being a little bit too reserved and calm, I need to help him out. While we're getting warmed up here, you can go to Genesis chapter 12. I get most of my sermons out of the Reader's Digest, but today I'm going to use the Bible, so we'll go to... 36 years. We left Faith Farm in Fort Lauderdale and... December 31st, 1982, and we got to Los Angeles, and we started our church February 3rd, 1983. My dream then was to pastor one church for a lifetime. Back in those days, pastors were hopping around and climbing the corporate ladder and all that. I didn't think that was good. So my dream was to start a church from scratch and pastor one church for a lifetime, and then use what I learn along the way in my old age. And so now I'm in my old age. I had hair when we started. I still do, but it's in the drain down at the... I didn't know that, 36 years in Los Angeles would be... it's different back. It's different out there than it is here. Anybody been to California? Let me see your hand. All right, we'll have a prayer line afterwards and help you guys out. I tell people I didn't move from California, I busted out. How many know the earth tilted and all the nuts rolled out to California? Y'all figured that out? I was thinking this morning, you know, there's been a lot of talk about closing the borders, protecting the borders, but you know what? Y'all got it wrong. You need to be protecting the western border of Texas. Keep all those California people. Send them to Idaho or something, y'all. Seriously, I was surrounded by good folks, but you had to collect them. They weren't everywhere. And now we're in Tennessee. And in my old age, we built a place for pastors to come and rest and get restored, or just, you know, just a place where pastors can... How many know pastors have a difficult job? In fact, before I get started, can I just say this? The mark of a professional is they make it look easy. And this man makes it look easy. I have no clue. I've been doing this all my life. I have no clue how he gets all this done. It's just amazing. And I got to correct that. You know, pastors are good people, but they will lie from time to time. And I just told one. I know how he gets it done. You guys are the ones that help him get it done. And you're the power that makes this thing work. And what a blessing to be in this place. When I was here last, this was just a... We drove by here, and this was part of the dream, I think it was. And look, can we just look around right now and say, look what the Lord has done? Can we do that? Amen. Look what the Lord has done, you guys. And you're just getting started. How many believe that the best is yet to come? I'm serious. Not only for this house, but for you as individuals as well. Amen. Now, why don't you just turn to somebody and say, my, you're looking good. I won't tell you how they say that in California, all right? No. Now, some of you had to lie there, so we'll have an altar call here in a minute. Introduction, and I do hope that as much as possible you can come back tonight and as much through the week as you're able. But I want to talk over the next few times about positioning and posturing for promotion, okay? I don't believe that the blessings of God are mystical. I don't think they just kind of come at you mysteriously. Can I just say this, and it might be something worth writing down, but the blessings of God are actually reciprocal. I'm just amazed at how many covenants and contracts are in Scripture. You know, God says, if you'll do this, I'll do that. And you know, how many know God, he'll always keep his side of the bargain. The problem is getting us to do what the Lord wants us to do. So I've learned over the years that we all live under the same sky, but we do not all share the same horizon. One of the disappointments of being a pastor is watching people with great potential never coming to their fullest potential. And it grieves you because you know that God actually had wonderful things in store for them, but somehow or another along the way, because of their walk or their unwillingness to come into alignment, they're not getting to enjoy the stuff that God had in store for them. So we're going to be talking about that over the next few days. But the life that we're living today is actually, a good sense of the word, has been greatly influenced by the decisions that we made yesterday. And one of these messages, I have a little list of things that I made up about being lucky. How many know if you're a child of God, there's no such thing as being lucky? You're either blessed or you're not blessed. Amen. And if what I said is true, and it is, whether you agree with it or not, it's true. where we're at today has largely been the outcome of decisions we made yesterday. If you're in a marriage and you're miserable, guess what? No one made you to marry. No, I'll leave that alone. All right. Again, we'll have an altar call in a little while. You can get that straightened out. Our successes tomorrow, though, also hinge on the decisions that we're making today and bringing ourselves into harmony and into alignment with what God's plan is for our life, you know. And our greatest blessings, one of our greatest blessings that God has given us is the power for us to choose how we're going to live our life. But I want to tell you right up front, this I'm in love with this right here. Amen. Right. Now, I got a study Bible, but my eyesight is not that great, so I just get these $12 large print Bibles, and I believe very much in this. I love this. I use my phone. I use my iPad, but I just can't see the president putting his in inauguration, putting his hand on an iPhone and taking the pledge. Use your smart stuff, but keep, you know, have yourself a Bible, you guys. You'll fall in love with it. You'll never want to get rid of it. But the Bible is chock full of stories of guys that did great things, and God blessed them in ways. And we still preach about them, and we look back at them. It's also full of stories of people that did some serious foolishness and made some serious decisions. Amen? And one of the greatest choices, though, or greatest blessings, is that God's given us the power to make those decisions. We can decide what we want to do, where we want to go. The most powerful decision you will ever make in your life, is to take responsibility for your own life, for your own circumstances. Amen? And not go through the world as a victim, not blaming others. I wish I had a few hours. I would tell you where I came from. But I will tell you this, the greatest joy in my life today is knowing where I started and where God took me. Amen. I'm telling you, I know what that was. I know my orientation to fail and what that was all about. And to be where I'm at and do the things that God's allowed me to do, it's just amazing how God wants to take us to great places in our lives if we'll just follow Him and let Him take us there. Amen? So the most powerful decision that we'll ever make is taking responsibility for who we are, where we are, and what we're doing. And I can remember the day that I decided to just become a wholly devoted follower of Jesus. Before that time, I was just became a Christian because they smell better and easier to get along with and all that. But there was that time in my walk with the Lord where I finally made a decision to just give Him everything that He had, that He asked for, and how He took me in such a short period of time from a mess to a place of just blessings. And so I can't tell the folks today. I really can't. One of the problems I have is I can't tell people how God has blessed me without it sounding like I'm bragging. Anybody relate to that? You know, no. I'm telling you, it would sound like he's all that in a bag of chips. I want to tell you, God has blessed my life. Can you say amen to that? And there's an old song, "Where Would I Be Without Jesus?" And you know, I still sing that song because I still feel that way. Can you say amen to that? So God's going to take you to places that you never dreamed that you could go. But He can't do it if we don't follow Him. Can you say amen to that? And so there is such a thing in this life as posturing or coming into alignment. And so I brought a couple of pictures. Let's see if I've got a place here. Put my little dog up there. I got a little dog. That's Emmy. We lived about 50. By the way, when your pastor saw my dog, he made fun of me. I'm serious. On Facebook, he said, "My dog will eat your dog." But, you know, I was in Los Angeles. If you had a 100-foot wide lot, you're like prospering out there, right? And so I couldn't have a moose like he had down here. But this is Emmy. We lived about 15 minutes from the Walk of Fame in Hollywood. And so we had an Oscar and an Emmy. And Oscar, he went on to be in the Happy Boneyard in the Sky. But this is Emmy. And I wish one of these days I'm going to preach a series of all the things I learned from my dog. But I have learned how to posture. When we got Emmy, he was given to us as a pastor's appreciation present one time. And it was just a little pup. And we made a deal, me and Deb, we said, we're not going to feed this dog from the kitchen table. We're only going to give this dog food. And that lasted about 4 or 5 weeks. And then we just like be eating pork chops and sleep, you know. And so I learned something watching Emmy. She knows how to posture. And so we'd be at the table. Now, she's always quiet, but we'd be at the table, and she'd be sitting there looking up at you. And I'm going to tell you what Emmy was saying. She was saying that if anything drops from this table, I'm getting it. How many's got a good picture of posture right now? How many know that God said He wants to give you good stuff? And if anything's going to drop from the Lord's table, can we just make a decision right here today? I plan to be in the right spot at the right time in the right place, looking up with my mouth ready to catch it if it falls from heaven. Can you say amen to that? So let's go to, I'm going to use a little bit of Bible here today, Brother Jerry. Don't panic, okay? He told me I had an hour and a half. Is that right? No? We'll beat the Baptists to the restaurants because y'all started early. But in Genesis chapter 12, I want to talk to you today, this morning, about something. I want to talk to you about altars. One of the things I've noticed is that, I've been to some seminars where it's church growth seminars. They tell you to get rid of the cross and don't use terms like the blood or the lamb. And I'm concerned about a subtle trend. How many know Satan is very subtle? Of altars disappearing in the life of believers. So I want to tell you a little story how this came about. I was into the whole teaching thing where you go through the points and 3 points in a poem, and everybody had notebooks and we're all taking notes and had our picture on the front and all that stuff. And I was about 16 years into pastoring, and I was just feeling like, yeah, we're teaching every week, we're teaching, and there's nothing wrong with teaching. That's not what I'm saying. But I got so hungry to see people's lives changed. You ever feel that way? And I just wanted to see some impact. I wanted to see something happen like what happened when I met Jesus. You know, where just bam, my whole life changed. You know, I mean, yeah, there was a progressive stuff that had to be walked out. But I mean, there was a sudden difference the moment I decided to let Christ into my life. Can you say amen? And I started looking back over all of the change points of my life and realized that all of those change points, they came at some kind of charged moment in the presence of the Lord. Despair, hunger, passion. It was never a spirit of apathy that brought a big aha moment into my life. And then I started realizing that they really came from times where I was at an altar. And let me be clear about this, okay? Now, in the Bible days, they built certain kinds of altars. But how many understand the altar can be the pew where you're at? It can be staring right here and all that. But Christians, believers, need altars in their life. And so I went back. I said, well, Lord, what's missing here? And I came to realize that there is a work of the Holy Spirit that after we've heard the word, then it's time to respond and let the Holy Spirit bring that home in real time to us. Amen? So I was looking at Abraham. That's where the blessing first started. Abraham, verse 1, chapter 12. Now the Lord said to Abram, Abram means father of many. Abraham later is, God changed his name to father of many nations because the Lord gave him a promise. But he says, Abram, get out of the country from where your kindred is and where your father's house into a land that I'm going to show you. Now this is interesting to me because Abram was not asking God for anything. It was God that came and tapped him on the shoulder. And in reality, God is saying to Abram, I got something good for you. I'm going to give you something much bigger, much better than you ever thought you could. How many know that? Let me take a breath. How many know that whatever you're thinking right now, God is thinking something bigger for you? That was weak. That sounded like a Baptist response right there. I was a youth pastor in a Baptist church, so a good one, all of them. How many know that whatever you're thinking, God is thinking usually something much bigger and better for you?
Yeah.
Come on, there you go. And so the Lord taps him on the shoulder. I'm going to make you great, a great nation. I will bless you. I'll make your name great, and you shall be a blessing to others. And I will bless them to bless you and curse them to curse you. You're going to just be a blessing to all the families throughout the earth. So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed from that place. Now, drop down to verse 6. And Abram passed through the land unto the place of Sychem, into the plain of Morah, and the Canaanites were there. There's going to be Canaanites in every blessing that God has for us. There's always something that we have to do. Can you say amen? There's always a part that God has put on us in order to walk out his blessings. But in verse 7 it says, and the Lord appeared unto him, Abram, and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. So can you get the setting for a minute? He left home, went to the place. Now he's at the place, but there's problems at the place. And the Lord visited him there, and he's looking at the problems. And the Lord says, but I'm going to give you, and later on in 13 you'll see this. He said, I'm going to give you this land. Even though the Canaanites are there, I'm going to give you this land. And it says, and so there he built an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. And so we see the first altar in Abram's life was an altar of promise. I came to the conclusion that when we go to a place of altars, guess what? God will meet us there. Amen? How many know that God will radically change your life if you just give him a moment in prayer? How many believe that prayer is important for a believer's life? Didn't Jesus say, my house shall be called a house of what?
Prayer.
Of prayer. And so when we go to this place of prayer, guess what? We meet with the Lord there. And all of a sudden, our destiny starts getting changed. And the Lord he starts these invitations. And I've learned that when God invites you to something, you better take it, because guess what? It's going to be way better than you ever thought it was going to be. I want to go through these the first three real fast. It says, the Lord appeared to him, and he said, so he built an altar at the place of promise. If we will make altars a normal, natural part of our everyday process, and listen, prayers, you know, New Testament says pray without ceasing, and I haven't figured out how to do that except that I use what I call micro prayers. You can be standing in the line at Kroger's. You can either be complaining about how long the line is, or you can look through the line and see who all's there and just start praying. Holy Spirit will reveal to you what that person needs prayer for. And you can be using those moments. And so you're praying without ceasing, because prayer and this altar place can be right there in the grocery store. Can you say amen? And while you're meeting with the Lord in prayer, guess what? The Holy Spirit shows up. And you'll get a promise out of that every time. Every time. The second altar I see in Abram's life is the next verse, in verse 8. It says, and he removed from thence into a mountain of the east of Bethel and pitched his tent. By the way, I really like the way the Bible gives us details. I mean, it tells you, right? If you've ever been to the Holy Land, you can see these pictures in your head. And if you haven't been to the Holy Land, then you kind of have to just imagine it. But the Lord gives these details, east and west of Bethel and all that. Having Bethel on the west and Hiah on the east, and there he built an altar unto the Lord. And look at the last line of verse 8. It says, and he called upon the name of the Lord there. So his second altar was an altar of prayer. It was a place where he just met with God in prayer. Now, as I said, the scripture says that Jesus said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Where I live out in California, did live, right down the road there was a car dealership called the House of Imports. How many would take a stab at what kind of car you think they sold there at the House of Imports? BMWs, Mercedes-Benz. Can you imagine going to the House of Imports and it's Chevrolets and, well, Dodge Rams? Probably would have been a good conversion. Can you say amen? But, you know, and I y'all have a house of pancakes here? You know, can you imagine going to the house of pancakes and ordering pancakes and say, yeah, well, we don't have any pancakes here. You know, I don't know if they did this back here, but out there last year they decided they were going to change the name. They had this advertising campaign of, it's now going to be the House of Hamburgers. Did anybody hear that? I thought, the House of Pancakes is becoming the house, like what we need, another hamburger stand in this country, you know? And then later they came back and said, oh, we were just joshing you, you know? We're still the house. Can you imagine going there? Can you imagine going to church, though, and nobody there prays? Yeah. Jesus said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. So Abram understood the power of altars, and that at that altar you come and you park there for a moment and you pray. I look back over my life and I notice that those were the change moments in my life. I just tell you a little story. I was at the director of Fort Lauderdale Faith Farm. It was a wonderful place. I still love it. I talked to the president of Faith Farm yesterday. And I still do some work down there from time to time. But I love that place. And I was, you know, it was a great ministry, Fixed for Life, all that stuff. But I was hungry for more. Have you ever been hungry for more? Has anybody here ever been uncomfortable being comfortable? Come on, you touched on this just a while ago, Pastor. Has anybody here ever been uncomfortable? You walk with the Lord, you're comfortable, and you get uncomfortable being comfortable. Can you? That's a wonderful place, you guys. And so I would leave my office, go over to the Sunday school rooms, and there were no windows, and so it was pitch dark in there. And for lunch, I would just fast and go sit before the Lord in this dark room on the floor, tile floor, no carpet. And every day I would just go over there and say, hey, man, Lord, I remember about the third day I was saying, God, I apologize for being unappreciative of what you have blessed me. I never dreamed I would even be in this position and, you know, all the perks that go with it. And I'm sitting on the floor and I said, Lord, I apologize for not being grateful for the blessings that you put in my life. And boom, just like, and the only way I know how to describe this voice came and it was like a combination of light and sound together. That's the only way I know how to explain it. But I'm sitting on the floor, totally unexpected, and all of a sudden this voice comes and I'm apologizing for not being thankful. And this voice comes and it says, this is not you, this is me. Just like that. And the very next words out of my mouth is, with astonishment, I said, oh man, Lord, you're moving us out of here, aren't you? And then the Lord began to talk to me. Yeah. Now, folks, if I didn't have that altar of prayer, I'd probably still be parked down there in Fort Lauderdale. But by the way, the next thing out of my mouth was, do we have a picture of my wife by any chance? Can we put that up there? The next thing, my wife ain't going to go for this, you know, because this means pulling up roots, moving from one ocean to the next ocean. We didn't know anybody in Los Angeles. But see, when you have your altar, when you make a place for altars in your life, and an altar, I think sometimes an altar can be defined as just a change in position. You know, right now in your pew, you could probably just say, Lord, I want to meet with you. And you could probably just lean forward. You know, maybe you don't have a physical somebody come carpenter build an altar. But you could just lean forward. Or you could get out on your knees if possible. And you could kneel there. It doesn't have to be some religious symbolic thing. It can just be a meeting place with God. It's a change of position. You're going to stop your routine. And you're going to make that spot where God, you know, where at this altar, just maybe the glory of God will come down at that moment. And so can I tell you, my life radically changed that moment because the Spirit of the Lord said, this is not you, it's me. Now, I always tell people I'm a little too pragmatic to be a pastor because y'all probably won't be back tonight when I finish this one. But
yeah, we will.
I've never been the kind of guy when I pray angels, you know, green ooze comes under the door and the cloud, you know, and I hear these voices. You know, I have people that I know that they have these like 30-minute conversations with God. That just never has worked that way with me. But I tell you what, all he has to do is say, this is not you, it's me. And guess what? I got the message. Amen. But had I not had that altar of prayer, I wonder where what direction my life would have been. Did we put that up? I had a picture of my wife up there somewhere. I thought if I was showing my dog, I better show my wife. There she is. I got her at Bible college. I didn't get a lot of Bible training so much, but I got a good wife out the deal. And if you got a good wife, that's all you need. She'll tell you what to preach. Amen. So the second altar is the altar of prayer. The third altar, we go over to chapter 13 and look at verse 1. And Abraham went on out to Egypt, and he and his wife and all that he had. And I think verse 2 is significant. It says, and Abraham was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. Now, that's not part of the message, but it does bear parking here for a minute and just say, you know, rich people have a harder time hearing from God sometimes than poor. I am really sensitive to hear God when I'm struggling. But when I am cruising on easy street, it's easy to forget God. And I just thought, you know, Abraham, even after he's rich, he's still building these altars to meet with God. And so verse 3, he went on his journey from the south unto Bethel and into the place where his tent had been at the beginning. We'll come back to that. And then verse 4, unto the place of the altar which he had made there at the first. And so the third altar we see here is an altar of promise, of permanence. You know, that when you make altars in your life, guess what? God gives you the blessings that no one can take away. A few weeks ago, I was speaking in another state, and while I was getting ready for it, I discovered something about the civil law. That there, you know, in our culture, there are covenants. I'm not talking about the biblical terminology of covenants. But there are contracts and there are covenants, and they're not the same. But what I learned was a contract has conditions that have to be fulfilled, but a covenant cannot be broken. If it's a covenant, you don't have to perform. It's just there. And so, you know, keep that in mind when you use the term Ark of the Covenant. But when it's a covenant, guess what? It's only one-sided. God made the covenant. He's going to stick with it regardless, right? And I'm going to tell you, I have screwed up in my life many times. I know none of y'all have. Right? I saw a picture there for a minute. I got to pass on because I'm going to run out of time. But I've screwed up many times. But I thank God that there's a covenant here, that God's pursued me. He made a covenant to take me to glory with him. Amen. The only way I can get away from that covenant is to deliberately turn and on purpose walk away from him, because he's going to hang on to me. Can you say amen? And so here it is. It's an altar of permanence. He goes back to the place which he had been there before. And there Abraham called on the name of the Lord again. And so that's the third altar in his life. The true value of altars are where we have our most powerful encounters with God. I look back over my life, started to say a while ago, and you know, I would preach these 3 points in a poem outlines, and I thought they were pretty good, but no one's life was really getting changed. And so one day I was just before the Lord, and I said, Lord, I'm so hungry to see what I saw growing up. I had a really good friend who was on staff at Brownsville Revival when the Brownsville Revival broke out. And he had lived with me for a year, and I called him up and I said, Lynn, I said, is this a man-made thing, or is this the Holy Spirit? You know, how many is familiar with the Brownsville Revival? I know I may be, that's been a while, but anyway, big revival broke out in the 90s in Florida, and millions of people were coming, and some of you know the story. So I called Lynn up and I said, is this a man-made thing, or is this? And here's just what he said to me. Remember all those mornings we used to talk about how the Holy Ghost used to move back in the day? And he said, this is not new. He said, the TV and magazines are all saying this is a new thing. He said, this is not a new thing. This is what God's always done. He said, he has just chosen to revisit us here at this time. You know, and so I was so hungry to see the power of God just move a person and just change them on the spot and fill us with passion to go out and be different. Can you say amen? And so the Lord began to show me that it was at those aha moments, a time of despair, time of hunger, a time of pressing in, a time where maybe all you do is just lean forward and say, God, I got to hear from you. I want to hear. You're just checking in with the Lord. Can you say amen? And that's your altar. And at that altar, the things of God become permanent in your life. How many plan to go to heaven? Let me. Yeah, some of you. No, we just. No, it's one thing to get saved, but it's another thing to survive earth and stay saved. Can you say amen? And I don't know about you. When I get on a plane, I don't want a pilot that's just learned to take off. He skipped the classes on landings. You know, I want this guy to bring it back down, right? And so it's not just enough to make a great beginning. I want it to be permanent. Amen. And the passion of the Lord comes at that altar, and it gives you the zest and the vitality to just keep on going. Altars are those places of powerful encounters with God. I remember a few years ago I was touring the Hoover Dam. Anybody ever been out there to the Hoover Dam out by Vegas? What were y'all doing out there in Vegas? I'm just left your gambling long enough to go look at. So we're down in that dam, and they're telling us all the statistics of the dam and stuff. And then one of the things they said, you know, when we built this dam to generate all this electricity, Vegas was just a small beginning community, and they passed up the opportunity to buy into the electricity from that dam. And I thought, you know what? I know a lot of Christians that way. Can you say amen? Amen. I know a lot of Christians that they're living with Hoover Dam, the Holy Spirit, right around the corner from them. And they're saying, no, we don't need that. I don't need that. You know, can I tell you, I want to tap into every megawatt of power that the Holy Spirit has available for me to survive planet Earth. Can you say amen? And altars are those places of divine encounters where your life gets changed. Now, I think it goes without saying that if we don't have altars, we may miss a few of those great moments. Altars are also a place of defining moments in our walk with the Lord. I was just in the middle of the night last night, I was thinking, you know what? I'm on my seventh now, but there's been six times in my life where the Lord has challenged me to just trust Him with everything I had. And you know, what's funny is when I was 17 and I left home, you know, I can't get into this because I'm going to run out of time, but I was living in a little camper trailer with a toaster and a 10-speed bicycle, and I went off to Bible college. And I felt like I was giving up a lot, y'all. But my mom was begging me not to go. She said, there's a Bible college 30 miles down the road. Go to that one. No, I'm going to Texas from California. And so, you know, just as a teenage kid, just freshly giving my life to the Lord, I was giving up everything I had in trusting God to meet me on the other side and do something great. Can you say amen? And He did. Like I said, I met my wife there. It changed everything. But as a 17-year-old, or no, just 3 days, 18 years old, I thought I was giving up a lot, but I wasn't giving up anything. And then over the years, the Lord would tap me on the shoulder and say, now I want you to go to this, and you got to give up this. And I would struggle with the giving up thing. And so I'd give up my bone, and then when I'd get to the other side, the Lord had a T-bone steak ready for me, you know. But viewed this side, it looked like it was going to be all sacrifice and no blessings. Can I tell you something? God has good stuff in store for you. Amen. Amen. And so at these altars where we meet with the Lord and the Spirit of the Lord comes and glory falls, guess what? Those become the moments of defining moments in your life. You get back, you know, you're 66 years old now and you're looking back over your life. You say, you know, I did that six times. And every time the Lord said, I want this, guess what? He's taking my wood shack away and giving me a brick building in its place. God's when God asks something of you, it is an invitation to something much better. There's usually going to be something up front that we give up. But at those altars, we hear from the Lord. At those moments where we close out all the noise, we stop the gyros, we calm things down, we sit in a dark room, and we just posture like Emmy. We're just sitting there waiting. Yeah, there's sometimes you go into that prayer room and you know, heavens are brass. But boy, you make those moments and guess what? Here comes a direction from the Lord. Here comes a promise from God. Altars are also places where sacrifices are made. So we make those sacrifices. I want to ask you a question. When was the last time you had a life-altering word or experience from God? We live in the noisiest, we probably live in the noisiest world that's ever existed on planet Earth. You know, in LA they say there's 3,000 commercial messages a day that you encounter. You know, you go to the bank ATM and they're trying to get you to do something. You drive down the road and there's a billboard. There's just everywhere. They're all wanting your attention. But I want you to know that if we'll find an altar, if we'll bring altars back into our life where we push out all the noise. Doctor the other day said, I need to get hearing aids. I thought, well, there is a bright side to hearing aids. At least I can turn them off every once in a while. So far, I've refused it. I don't want no peanut hanging behind my ear, but sooner or later, I'll have to do it. Altars can be a, last thing I want to say, altars can be a collection of hard things. You know, people, in the middle of the night, I saw this. My mom used to sew a lot, and she had this little stuffed fabric tomato. I think it was a tomato. Pin cushion. And all these pins are stuck in this thing, and this is where she got her needles and pins. And in the middle of the night, I saw this. I hadn't seen this thing in 30 years, but I thought, you know, there are some Christians that are walking around with these pins. Somebody hurt you. Or you're in a church that went belly up, or you went through a divorce, or the company fired you, or, you know, fill in the blank. And we think we got that dealt with. And yet there's a residue of it still lingering inside that never got washed out. You see, altars in the Bible days were built out of rocks for the most part. And you can pick up rocks of wounds or hurts and you can carry them around and they can become the eye mark of who you are and they're your identity and You're getting a lot of pleasure out of being the victim. You don't even know it. You don't even know it. Or you can pick that rock up that someone hurled at you and you can throw it back at them and punish them. It doesn't matter if you throw it. Doesn't matter if you hold on to it. Doesn't matter if you polish it. But I believe what the Lord would want us to do is to take those hard things and stack them up and make them into an altar and give them to the Lord. Amen. And get rid of the anger. And so the fourth altar that Abraham had, and I know I'm out of time, but in verse 14 through 18, he built a final altar, and it was a place of possession. And there it says that he worshiped the Lord. So I want to end this morning, and maybe, I don't know exactly how you do this, but maybe if you would just stand with me. I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit, if you would, just go ahead and play, feel free to play something. But I want to ask you, if you would, just to bow your heads for just a moment. And you can lean forward, or you can just change your position for a moment. And we want to end up at this fourth altar where we return to the altar of God. And the scripture says, and God's glory descended there. If you would just bow your heads for a minute. I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to bring to remembrance anything that's got to be dealt with. And I'm not saying dredge it up so you can regurgitate it and regenerate all of the carnal responses to it. I was 24 years old before I knew I hated my father. I hated him. I was waiting for a moment to do damage to him and didn't even know it. That's the part that blows me away. I didn't even know it. But for years I had been rehearsing how I was going to get back at my dad. And in a moment, and I'm hoping that there's a few of those here today. In a moment, in an altar, the Holy Spirit showed me that I had all this stuff behind a partition inside of my heart. And I was like my mom's pincushion. There was a residue and an accumulation of stuff that I felt I had been cheated out of. So today, Father God, we take every stone that's ever been brought, hurled at us. And maybe right now the Holy Spirit would give you one or two specific ones. The only guy that ever cheated me out of a lot of money was a pastor. It took me years to finally just say, he doesn't owe me anything. God, I take that stone, I pile it up on, I make an altar, and I worship the Lord Jesus. I just worship you, God. And I want to keep altars in my life for the rest of my life. So Holy Spirit, we ask you, if you would, if there is a residue or any javelin sticking out of folks here today that they haven't dealt with, Lord, that you would just let us release it right now. Just Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Pull it out of us. Set us free, Father God. Let us just, like David said, just restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Yes, Lord. Yes. And so, Lord, we purpose as a response to today to build ourselves an altar and there worship you. Just worship you. A place where we can meet with God on a regular basis. Promises, prayers, permanence, and position. All of those are wonderful altars. We choose to keep them in our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. God bless you.
The last 2 months of January, February, the most powerful times that I've had in those 2 months was not the Beast Feast. It was not Sunday morning with you. It was a couple of Tuesday nights that we had in here for prayer.
Yeah.
It was those altar moments. And I know exactly what Pastor Don's saying, because I'm the same way. Sometimes we minimize the house of God, real altars. And we tell you, hey, and you've heard me say it, you can do it on your motorcycle, you can do it in your deer stand, you can do it here. But in saying that, sometimes we take away the need for the house, the need for the real altar. Sister Dolly? David Cochran?
Yes.
Okay, we'll pray for David. Been down that road with David a few times.
Yes, you have.
Amen. But see, that's going to be an altar of time. It's something that alters your life. I mean, when you mentioned that, I thought, boy, if there's any church and any man that needs it, it's me. There's something about them altered moments. The passing of a friend, Kelly Smith, who worked with us out at the ranch for a season. So she's a big gal. This is, maybe, a big bone woman, you know, passed away last night. She lives in the Beaumont or Port Arthur area. So we have these altered moments. They alter you. I want you here tonight. I want you to honor God with you. Just being able to get here. I know some of you have things that are going on. Your Sunday night is like it used to be for my life. It was sacred. You watched Disney. Bonanza, yeah. Well, that don't happen no more. You can DVR it. I know you. You got one. Just like I do. So be here tonight at 7 o'clock. We'll eat together. Be seated just for a brief moment. I get our servant leaders to come up. We are pressing for a little time here. Do you know when I give my tithe, I'm saying to God, I appreciate what you've blessed me with this week. I'm appreciative of the life you've given me, and I want to show my appreciation first, not only by my tithe, but by my offering. And throughout the week, every week that I know of, I'm looking for an opportunity to sow into somebody else's life. And I do. I look for it. I put it in their hand. Because I'm like you, Pastor Don. I know where you came from. I think you know a little bit about where I came from. I know it's been a repetitive story in here for them to hear about my outhouse and picking cotton and stuff. But I'm going to tell you, I'm very thankful for where I'm at right now, what God has done in my life. And I work with men and women who have come through the same thing, that are learning how good God is. You know, if... So if you need an offering envelope, you can make your check out, of course, to the little country church. Give over and above, because we got to bless Don so I can get him back to Tennessee. I have no desire to keep him more than Thursday. He came in yesterday agitating me right off the bat. I was just, it's like God sent him here to pick at me. It's like an older brother. I love it. It's good stuff. Quick announcements, guys. Again, tonight, 7 o'clock. Everybody say 7 o'clock. You got to remind yourself. You have to set your clock, have somebody call you. If you're watching online, I'd love for you to show up at church tonight and come be a part of this. I know some are battling sicknesses. Some can't get out of the house. I understand that. Man, I understand that. But I'd love to have those of you that are bedside Baptist in this morning to get to the house of God. Amen. And we're going to do this tonight. We're going to do it again Tuesday night here. And then Wednesday night out at the ranch. So you have three. You said you're running out of time. No, you didn't run out of time. We're just preempting some of it to finish it tonight. We're going to have some altar time tonight. We're going to believe God to alter people's lives. For you to have that moment. That it's almost like a crisis when Jacob wrestled with God. It's those, that's where altars come from. It's when I finally gave in to God. Okay, there's the altar. That's good. We're going to have ropes course this week. Is it this week? We're going to have. So we got a camp coming. We already starting camps again. So we got 60-something kids coming to this camp this weekend. So Friday we will do a ropes course. So any of the OCDs, OCD, old, cantankers, and dangerous, if you'd like to come out and help us, anybody that's off that day, like to come out, 9:30, we'll be throwing them off the tower. I love throwing people off the tower. My goodness, what a joy. Especially kids, teenagers. This little outfit, I know this outfit that's coming. They're from a place called Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel, it's a private school. And they don't know sick 'em from come here about country living. I actually ask them, I ask this question, where is Mount, do you know where Mount Carmel come from? They had no idea that that's where Elijah got into it with cut the bull and poured off. And I'm like, you guys ought to know that if that's your school. Of course, I went to a school called New Bethel. And I didn't know what Bethel was until I got born again. So I guess I'm the same way. So ropes course this weekend. Seniors, you meeting next week? Okay. It's already March. Amen. The 21st will be a kids and daddy-daughter dance. Amen. Keep in mind, guys, make sure you block out April the 5th, Muscle Car Sunday, April the 5th. We got to get the word out. We got a month now to prepare. It's quick. Ma'am? Lift is today. The ladies having a lift meeting today with Sister Diane right after church. It's wonderful. Father, we lift up Patsy to you. Lord help me, Terry and David Cochran to you, and Patsy and Donald, the whole family. We pray for David's recovery. God, for this crisis moment to cause an altar in his life. We're praying for just your hand to be involved in that. We thank you for the offering tonight, today. We thank you for the blessing of the Word of God. We love you in Jesus' name. As we give today, we're believing God for more money. Sales and commission, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, bills paid off, settlements, inheritance, rebates and returns, debts demolished, royalties received, favor and success to the kingdom.
I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy.